Which pizza would you eat? I'm gonna guess, I'm gonna take a stab in the dark here, that most of you went with a safer option, hopefully. The one without the mold, right? So you guys were able to make that decision real quick. And that's because we're wired to use our senses every day to make these decisions, including what to eat. And if we decide to actually take food and put it into our mouths, then taste is the final line of defense before that food goes into our stomach and into our bodies. And at that point, there's only two options: to eat or to spit out. And this is courtesy of my sister and I when we were babies, and I'm the one spitting up. In this way, taste equals survival. So let's talk about survival and taste. So here are the five tastes, and each of them provide a unique survival advantage. And we're gonna start with the one that we like the least, and that's bitter. We're born not liking bitter. And that's because bitter equals poison in terms of survival, just like this poisonous hemlock here. But we can learn to like bitter things once we realize they're not poison, and a great example is caffeine, coffee. So let's go to the other end of the spectrum. What are we born loving? Sweet. Let's roll with sweet right now. We love sweet because it is the taste of pure energy via simple carbohydrates like sugar. Now, similarly, we love umami. Umami is the savory taste of protein, another thing we need for our bodies to survive. All right, now we're going to talk about a funky one, and that's sour, because it can either help us or harm us. So we tend to like weak acids like citric, and that's probably because we've evolved to need to like it so that we get vitamin C. But we do not like strong acids, like that in a car battery, right? That's going to kill us, right? We're not going to consume that. So the final one is salt. And salt is a concentration game as well. And it has to do with you right now and your body. When your body needs salt to maintain fluid levels or other internal processes, we crave it. And when we crave salt, salt tastes good. When our body doesn't need it, we tend not to crave it. And that same concentration of salt doesn't taste as good anymore. All right, so I just laid out for you taste. Taste is pretty logical and pretty straightforward when it comes to survival. I think it's too simple, actually. So I want to throw a wrench in what you think you know about taste. And that's because if evolution and survival are so complicated as we know they are, why would something so important to survival like taste, which helps us to find food and stay away from poisons and toxins, why would taste be so simple? So I was curious about this, and I asked the question, why five? And it turns out I'm not the only scientist asking this question. There are scientists across the country and the world that are looking at other important nutrients to see if they actually have a taste. And here are some examples. Calcium, complex carbohydrates like starches, pure water even. Can you imagine if that's a taste? But the one that's most interesting to me, and I think the one that has the most evidence, is the last one, which is fat. Could fat be the sixth taste? And this is the focus of my research. All right, so I'm out to prove that fat is the sixth taste. And in order to do that, you have to answer a lot of questions. There is a laundry list of experiments that we need to do. But the one that's most intriguing to me as a geneticist is this. Is there a gene for fat taste? All right. Can you imagine? So, let's do a quick detour on genetics to make sure that everybody's on the same page. Your ability to taste is wrapped up in tens of thousands of years of your family history through evolution. And all of that evolution is written today, right now, right in you, in your DNA. So, if you think about your DNA like a cookbook for your body, then like any good cookbook, your DNA cookbook has genes. These are recipes, right? So recipes or genes, same thing. They are the instructions telling your body how to make something it needs to survive. And to tie it back to taste, my goal is to find the gene or recipe for fat taste. So now we need to think like scientists. I've got nothing on the screen behind me because I want you to use your imagination. Put yourself in my shoes as a geneticist. What would I need in order to prove this? And no matter what type of scientist you are, the answer is the same. And that's data. Data is king, okay? So since we're studying humans and we're studying taste and genetics, I'm gonna need data from humans. So I'm gonna need thousands of people to come into my lab to do taste tests, to answer questions about themselves, and to do a cheek swab, kind of like the CSI shows, except for we're gonna use it to study taste genes. All right, you got that all in your mind? Now who's doing all this work? Scientists. Trained scientists, highly trained scientists. I'll get to that, don't worry. Highly trained scientists who are gonna take in that data and then concurrently, they're going to analyze that data. So that means we need a lab that has really cutting edge genetics equipment. Everybody got that picture in their mind? Great, does it look something like this? So this is what we think about. This is in terms of like what we think a real lab and a real scientist look like. This is what we typically think. And these represent the stereotypes around science. And I know that you thought that I was just gonna come up here and give you a talk about taste and blow your mind because I was gonna tell you fat's the sixth taste. But actually, I'm here to do one more thing. And that's, I wanna change the very way you think about science itself. And if you believe in stereotypes that look like this, in a lab that looks like this, that's probably not gonna happen. But it could happen in a lab that looks like this. It's open, it's inviting, and it's real. And it's the genetics lab I lead at the Denver Museum of Nature and Science. And we don't fit any stereotypes. But we have everything we need in order to find out if there is a gene for fat taste, including our highly trained scientists. Our scientists are volunteers from the community, just like you and just like Vanessa here, who come in and get trained to become citizen scientists. So Vanessa told me that when she learned about this opportunity to be in our lab, she thought the world just opened up for her. She couldn't believe her luck. She was at a volunteer fair. She's going from booth to booth to booth. You can imagine how exciting it was. And then she came to our booth, and we said, yeah, you can volunteer to be a scientist in our lab. We'll train you. We're studying genetics and taste. It's funded by the NIH. She said, that was it. I was hooked. And Vanessa's not alone. We've trained over 100 citizen scientists since we've started, and they are the heart of our research. Collecting data 364 days a year from participants just like you who come into our lab, want to be a part of real research, and are interested in proving that fat's the sixth taste. But it doesn't just end at data collection. In fact, our citizen scientists have the opportunity to learn more, do more, and take on more responsibility in the lab. And this is two great examples behind me. So the very focused young woman with a pipette, that's Valeria. She's in the process of analyzing a DNA sample to see how much DNA is in there. And she did this right immediately after extracting that DNA from cells that were collected from the cheek swabs. And then that DNA is gonna go over to Emma, who's sitting at the bench. And Emma's gonna process all of that DNA in order to sequence it, which is like the equivalent of reading that recipe. So we're gonna sequence or read these genes, and then we're gonna try to figure out if anything that we see and read is related to the taste data. And in this way, we're gonna find the gene for fat taste. So this is, I can't emphasize enough, this is real research being done by real people, and it's leading to real results. And because of that, it's our duty to make sure that these discoveries are always available to anyone who's interested in them. And that means that we have and we will continue to publish in journals that offer free online access. And I think that's really important, because the discoveries that you help us make as the community should never be locked behind any walls. So let's pause here, because I really want you all to take this in. We're challenging not only the central dogma of taste, right? Who do we think we are? Trying to prove a sixth taste? But we're also challenging the very way science is done. And in that way, I want to change the way you think about science. So if any of you have ever been in this situation where you've saw this face, you can imagine I've come upon some obstacles in challenging the way things are done. I've been dismissed for doing work that is deemed too frivolous compared to traditional natural history museum topics. Also, work that is not serious enough for academic research. In fact, and I kid you not, there have been times where I thought people might just reach out and pat me on the head and tell me how cute it was that I was trying to do this work. There's a lot of ways to respond to that, and we chose the high road. And that is, we kept a smile on our face, and we worked harder than anyone else. And now we have the data to support all of this work that we're doing. And data is king, remember that. So data, no matter how much good stuff we're doing in the community, data is what's going to silence the naysayers and the doubters and the haters. And that's powerful in what we do. So now what's next? We're proving that the community engagement in science is making a huge difference in where science goes, right? This is the future of science, and we want you to be a part of it. So here's what's next. Maybe taste isn't your thing. That's OK. There are hundreds of citizen science projects across the world and the country at scistarter.com that you can participate in. From there, we want to keep this conversation going. Let's get rid of stereotypes, right? Let's change the way that together we think about science. And I want you to inspire me. So we had this crazy idea that the community could do real genetics work, and it's working. So use hashtag crazy taste idea, and your idea could be the next big discovery in my lab. And finally, visit us in Denver. Be a part of history as we prove that fat is the sixth taste. Cheers.